Welcome to Rearranging Change, how you market to an ever-changing world. I'm your host, Steve McChesney.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode number 9. As we continue with our motivators and what motivates people to take action. Again, there's 12 of them. Today, we're going to talk about sensory appeal. Now, sensory appeal is anything that you can taste, touch, smell, hear, or see. It can include how something makes you feel emotionally, like laughter, sadness, anger, love. All of those are sensory appeal, anything that deals with how you sense things. Now, I'm going to give you an example that sensory appeal doesn't always have to be real. It doesn't have to be something you actually smell or you actually feel or touch. It's what your brain can imagine. Now, imagine yourself standing in your kitchen, okay? And on the counter is a beautiful bowl of fruit. The colors are brilliant. They're red and green apples. There's bright yellow bananas, green and purple grapes. There are plump oranges and bright yellow lemons. I mean, see that bowl of fruit. I want you to really imagine it, okay? Now, I want you to take one of those lemons, and I want you to bring it to your cutting board. Okay, use a sharp knife. Cut the lemon in half. Notice how juicy that lemon is. In fact, the juice glistens as it drips from the knife's blade. Pick up half of that lemon, right? Just bring it under your nose and smell it. Smell the citrus. Now bring it to your lips, and I want you to squeeze and just suck in that powerful juice. Ooh. Did you pucker just a little? Well, that's sensory appeal. See, if you can imagine it and you can paint a colorful enough picture for your customer, they can imagine it, they will experience sensory appeal. Now, I remember when I was a kid, I used to go to the movies, and in those days, they had an intermission in the movies, right? You know, half the movie would play, then they'd have an intermission, and it was designed to give you time to go to the snack bar and buy, you know, your soda and your popcorn and things like that. But what they would do is they'd sneak in a frame of a picture of Coca-Cola or popcorn. And it's one frame. Now remember, it's 32 frames per second. So like one frame would flash and you wouldn't even notice it, but your subconscious mind would see it right before that intermission came. So they were using sensory appeal. You'd see that popcorn or that Coke, and now you have an intermission, time to go to the snack bar. Brilliantly done with subliminal. Now, companies still use sensory appeal today. I'll give you a good example. You ever walked through an airport and you smelled Cinnabon? What's that make you want to do? Go get a Cinnabon. Absolutely. Clothing companies use sensory appeal. They talk about how a fabric will feel on your body, how nice it is, or how shoes feel on your feet. Is there cushion? Is it giving, you know, helping with that arch support? That's all sensory appeal. Perfumes. You walk through a mall, there's always somebody there whipping poor perfume at you, aren't they? Or even this, you get into a magazine, if you open up, sometimes there's a flap that you open up and you smell that perfume. Well, they're using sensory appeal, any kind of scratch and sniff, things like that. Colognes are the same way. Restaurants will use sensory appeal. A good example, if you look at a billboard for McDonald's, for instance, and you see this beautiful Big Mac sandwich, it's gorgeous. Of course, that never looks that way when you actually get one, but the way they present that, it makes, if you're hungry, you want to stop at McDonald's and get one of those. That's using sensory appeal. Mattress companies, beds, sensory appeal. How does it feel? How does it feel in your body? Is it comfortable? Furniture stores do the same thing. Even sheets, when you buy sheets, you buy, you know, 400 count thread counts or 800 count thread counts. It's designed for the feel. How's that feel on you? The shoes that you wear, car dealerships use sensory appeal. Get behind the wheel of a car. How does it feel in that cockpit, in that captain's chair? Does it feel good? It's all using sensory appeal. RV manufacturers do it. Boat companies do it. So sensory appeal is all around us. And it's a very strong motivator because anything that you can create that causes your customer to see, feel, hear, taste, it's going to help in your sales. So sensory appeal is a huge motivator. That's our lesson for today. Listen. Send me an email, steve@rearrangingchange.com. Anything you'd like to talk about, I'd be happy to talk about. If you'd like to be a guest on my show, send me an email at steve@rearrangingchange.com. We're going to be right back with our pal, Ron Seggi.
My friends, I'd like to offer you a free copy of my international best-selling book, Rearranging Change, How You Market to an Ever-Changing World. Just simply go to rearrangingchange.com. That's RearrangingChange.com. Rearrangingchange.com. I will pay for your book. You simply pay for the shipping and handling. Once again, a little gift from me, Rearranging Change, How You Market to an Ever-Changing World. Go to my website, rearrangingchange.com, and get your free copy today.
And we're back. And as always, after the commercial, we bring it to our friend Ron Seggi, who's with us again this week. Hey, Ron, how are you?
I'm doing good, Steve. I heard you talking about sensory and the desire to build a demand predicated on smell. You know, in real estate, they do that all the time. I remember one time I was selling a house and they said, could you bake a pie and could you, you know, bake a cake? And I said, well, these people are going to eat here that are going to come through? He said, no. In fact, I don't even want to take it out of the oven. I just want them to smell the aroma of bakeries being baked because it makes it homey. And that kind of builds empathy with them that, man, this could be our home.
Oh, that's brilliant. I'm gonna put that in my next book. That's good. Thank you, Ron. I'll give you credit though on that particular item. Okay. Who'd you bring out of the vault for us this week?
Well, a guy that I've known for a long, long time. It goes back to the early 70s. And one of the nice things about what I've done in my career is I've been able to work with the people that I've, you know, as growing up, kind of idolized. And as a performer and as a singer, this guy sold a ton of records. He was the full package. I mean, he was absolutely colossal being a multi-million selling record artist. He would take songs by the late, and we just lost him, Little Richard, like Tutti Frutti, Good Golly Miss Molly, Long Tall Sally. And he would give them a more homogenized sound. And radio stations were playing because Little Richard's versions were, at that time, so shocking. And that's my friend Pat Boone. And there's a funny story about that I want to tell real quick, is that I worked a couple of dates with Pat Boone as his opening act. That is very unusual. You very seldom have a male singer opening for a male singer or a female singer opening for a female singer. Normally you have a comedian or a juggler, then the singer, or the singer, then the headliner is the comedian, but you never have somebody that does what you do because you could outshine them. And I did it in the areas that were close to my hometown where a lot of my friends came to, but he didn't care. He said, I have all the confidence in you, you're gonna do a good job, and I have all the confidence in me that I'm the headliner.
Well, great, I'm looking forward to the interview. Let's listen.
On a day like today, we pass the time away, writing love letters in the sand.
And we are back live all across the USA and around the world. It's Ron Seggi today. And boy, I don't know where to start. I mean, that's the great voice of a man that I met back in 1972 for the first time, 47 years ago. And he's joining.
Man.
He is the full package, my friend Pat Boone. Hey, Pat, how are you?
Boy, that's a stunner. How many? 42?
47. Back in 19.
Wow.
You were gracious enough, Pat, to let me be your opening act in some concerts up in Pennsylvania. You never let another male singer lead off for a male singer star.
It is unusual, yeah. But you know, I started out in high school doing a radio show in Nashville, and though I was an aspiring pop singer, I didn't dream I would actually have a career, but I was hosting a teenage talent show and introducing other singers around Nashville to come on and sing on my show. And then later on my Pat Boone Chevy show on national television in the late 50s, I would have all the other singers come on and sing with me. And, you know, I have an album of duets with Nat King Cole, Johnny Mathis, Perry Como, Sammy Davis, Ella Fitzgerald. I just love singing with and enjoying other singers. So me with you was something that was very comfortable for me.
Well, I appreciate that, and you were terrific. I have a picture, by the way, of us backstage back then, and you looked great. I looked like Tiny Tim back in the 70s. Holy jeez, oh man.
You're an Armed Forces Radio, I think, aren't you?
Yes.
And, you know, I had the number one most requested song for about 4 years in the late 50s, I'll Be Home. And it was the song that so many of our armed forces people were requesting on armed forces radio, because those who were away from home were hoping that their loved one was going to wait for them. And the ones back home were requesting the song because they wanted their loved one away from home to come home safely. So the I'll Be Home song, originally done, I think, by the Flamingos.
Yes, you're right.
And I had recorded it, and it was such a huge record for years. I still sing it in many of my shows, and I'm still doing concerts. Anybody from that era in my audience, after this many years, they're thinned out now, but they want to hear I'll Be Home.
I'll Be Home, yeah. Well, you know, your achievements and your versatility, I always said to you, you always have this unique knack of reinventing yourself and being accepted in those reinventions. I mean, recently here, the 48th Annual GMA Dove Awards on October 17th for a Lifetime Achievement Award, then the 20th anniversary of Metal Mood, No More Mr. Nice Guy. I was in the audience when you did the Jay Leno show at the MGM when you came out on that.
Were you?
Show. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that was a shocker.
It was. In fact, it was dangerous because he had me ride somebody else's motorcycle out onto the stage, right up to the edge of the stage. And if I hadn't known how,
you'd have gone.
Stop and put up the kickstand and shut it off while they were playing the intro to Smoke on the Water, and I had to jump off and start singing. If I had just been flustered for a second, I could have run that motorcycle right out into the audience.
Yeah, and it would have been a great...
You were there.
I was there.
You.
It would have been a great insurance claim, Pat. I mean, I tell you.
Yeah.
Hey, Pat, tell us more about what's happening with the Gold Label Artists. I'd love this label. What you've done with this label is sensational.
Well, I call it the senior tour for singers, like in golf and tennis. You know, you really like to see those who've already been champions still performing in those sports. And singers, many of them still performing, but they're not on any label, including me.
Right.
So I, out of anger and opportunism, the record labels had dropped artists who had helped build those labels and had sold millions of records, but just because they weren't the current new thing, the record companies were dropping these legends. But to me, it was an opportunity to bring them together and do new albums and still reach that large audience as long as they were still performing, and so many of these artists were. So in the first 3 years of the Gold Label, we put out 26 new albums, like Jack Jones and Sha Na Na and Patti Page and Roger Williams, and then of course I joined in.
Sure.
The Four Freshmen and the Letterman and all these great artists who weren't on any label. The only trouble was that the company that with whom we were inventorying and manufacturing and distributing went bankrupt just as we hit our stride. Their bankruptcy tied up all of our masters and music for well over a year, and it stopped the momentum. But I'm still really proud that we put out Glenn Campbell's last album.
Right.
And I knew that that would be the case, that at some point Gold Label would be putting out the last albums by these legendary artists. So that's happened, and you go to Gold Label, Pat Boone's Gold Label on the internet, or just patboone.com, you can find out about and buy the albums. Of course, people are still buying albums, but you can also go to just the free Pat Boone app and download, and I'll sing for you 24 hours a day of my own stuff.
Wow, that's great.
Only singer that has his own free app, forming all my own records for anybody that wants to listen, free of charge.
Let me tell you something, Pat.
That's why we do all that.
This venture and your voice and the voices of all the people you mentioned will live on long after you and I are gone, and that's what's great. Something else you're doing, and I really meant when I said reinventing yourself. I mean, because, you know, you had an R&B record out not too long ago that we talked about. Not too long ago, it was a few years ago. It seems like only yesterday. But tell us about this historic pilgrimage that you're making to the Holy Land.
Well, thanks, Ron. That's another of my lifelong, really, or at least career-long activities and priorities, and that's my association with the people of Israel. I'm Christian, but I call myself an adopted Jew because my rabbi is that carpenter's son from Nazareth. I consider myself part of the extension of Judaism, that is Messianic Judaism. And I wrote the song, which is really considered the second Jewish national anthem, "This land is mine, God gave this land to me, the theme song from the movie Exodus. I wrote those words on the back of a Christmas card, kind of combining. Didn't intend it that way. I grabbed the first piece of white paper I could lay my hands on when the idea for the lyric coming to me turned out to be the back of a Christmas card. That card is framed and on display at Yad Vashem, the Holocaust Museum in Jerusalem, and on the wall of the Righteous Gentile, along with Oscar Schindler and Ori Ten Boom and other Christians who risked their lives to rescue Jews during the Holocaust period and from Nazi Germany. So I'm woven into the history now of the people of Israel, and I'm hosting this tour next May, May 9th through the 20th, and that incorporates May 14th, which is the actual anniversary date of the founding of the modern state of Israel, which was May 14th and 70 years ago.
Right, right.
48.
Right.
So I'm going to be doing concerts in Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, like I did last March, sold out concerts in their big theater, but also in the Caesarea Amphitheater, the Roman Amphitheater, Caesarea, looking out on the ocean there. And we'll do a video, a TV special there, using Israeli and American artists and featuring them. And it's going to be a big, big deal. And
that's great.
Go to PatBooneIsraelTour.com to learn all about it. Come with me.
That's what I was going to ask you. That's how we can join you with that, Pat? Go to PatBoone.com?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
PatBooneIsraelTour.com and come with me, because it's going to be a first rate. We'll have a private audience with the Prime Minister, who is a friend of mine. He calls me Speedy because he was in college, MIT, when my record was in full bloom. And I recorded Speedy Gonzalez, which he loves. So every time I'm together with Prime Minister Netanyahu, he says, "Hello, Speedy, come on in."
That's funny. Well, you know, Pat, I know that you're on a horrendous schedule, okay? But, you know, I've only touched the tip of the iceberg. I'd love to talk to you about all the stuff you do, but every time I get you on, we really have to catch up like 10 years.
Radio tours.
Yeah, I know that. But will you join us again? I had dinner one night with Debbie, Dick Van Dyke, myself, my partner, the late Ed McMahon. We had a great time. She's a darling girl. She really
is. Oh, yeah. I think it was Dick on a special with her, I believe, a TV special. Yeah. But Debbie's still singing full time.
Yeah.
And her kids are raised. That little girl of You Light Up My Life is now a grandmother.
I know.
But she looks like her own daughter or one of her own grandkids.
Beautiful girl. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Pat, will you join us again soon?
I will.
I would love to talk to you more about all the stuff that you're doing. And, you know, between now and May, we can chat some more about the trip to the Holy Land. How about that?
We'll look for the chance. Yeah.
Okay, Pat, my friend, thank you so much for joining us. Our special guest has been our longtime friend, Pat Boone.
Now, you know, Ron, it's interesting from a business standpoint that Pat Boone would start the Gold Label record company for the senior bands and singers to an avenue for them to release their last albums. I mean, that was pretty smart.
That was really, really smart. And I remember when he did that, too. And of course, he explained in that interview that the distributor went bankrupt, so it kind of went a little bit sour.
That's
but
business
when
too.
I saw that several years back when he started that, I thought, what a stroke of genius, okay? Because he's right. You know, this is a tough business. You get eaten up alive. You got people like, and he mentioned him, Jack Jones and Glenn Campbell.
The Letterman, yeah.
Billions of dollars for RCA. The Letterman, as you mentioned. So many of them, okay? And himself included, that end up with a gold watch and no record label. So what he did was really, really good. Unfortunately, it's a tough business to stay in. And the conventional way of selling records now is a little bit different online. So it lost its footing, but it was a great business move, I think.
Well, it was. And I'll tell you, the other thing I liked about what he said in that interview was, you know, he's a man who branded himself. Everybody knows the name Pat Boone, who he is, but nobody really listens to him anymore, except he was pretty smart. He's now using modern technology. He put out an app with all of his songs on it, and it's free, so people can listen to him. It's like reinventing yourself again. I think that's a pretty smart idea.
He's a pretty astute businessman, let me tell you. You know, everybody kind of laughed at him in the beginning because he was doing all of these, as I mentioned before, really homogenized versions of these rock and roll songs. You know, about 10 years ago, and I had him on my show when he did this. In fact, calls are pouring in right now, I want you to know. They are just flowing in like crazy. That's what happens when I do your show. Boy, they just come in like crazy. But anyway, I was starting to say is that he recorded a CD of all rhythm and blues songs, including stuff by Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Wow.
And I was with him the night that he introduced some of those songs on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno, and they were doing it at the MGM Grand in Las Vegas. And when he made his entrance, he came out in a black leather suit, kind of like the 68 special that Elvis Presley came out with, and one of Jay Leno's Harleys. And he told me afterwards, and I think he said it on
the interview, yeah.
He almost fell off the stage, you know. But the fact that, and then he came out and sang an Earth, Wind, and Fire song.
Wow.
So you got to give him a lot of credit because he is a kind of a chameleon when it does that. And, you know, let me just say something else without being too breathy here. Back in the mid-50s when he started off, unlike all the other rock and roll idols, he had already been in college. He was going to college when he had all these hits. He was already married, and he already had four daughters.
Wow.
So it wasn't like an Elvis Presley or a Fabian or a Frankie Avalon who was everybody's eligible bachelor. This guy was a married family man, yet the teenagers loved him. The White Bucks, the whole nine yards.
Wow. And speaking of his daughters, the one that's very famous, obviously, Debbie. He mentioned that she's now a grandmother.
Yeah.
Man, that makes me feel old.
Yeah, I didn't like that. I had dinner with her one night. It was Ed McMahon, Tony Orlando, me, Debbie, and Jerry Van Dyke, Dick Van Dyke's brother, who was on Coach and everything.
Right.
She's just a beautiful girl, a woman, grandma.
Wow. So amazing. Once again, Ron, thank you very much. And I'm always excited to see who you bring to this show. It's so much fun. We'll see you next week, huh?
See you, Steve.
All right, man. And thank you all. That's the end of this particular episode. Again, like I always tell you, please send me an email at steve@rearrangingchange.com if you have any questions or comments. And until we meet again next week.
Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time on Rearranging Change. Make sure to visit my website, stevemcchesney.com. Sign up for my newsletter. We'll be talking soon.